Good afternoon. Welcome to Sports and Other But Sports with Kent Sterling for Tuesday, August 6th, 2019. Brought to you by the great people at Today's Dentistry. Dr. Mike O'Neill, simply the best dentist that there is. He's compassionate, he's empathetic, he's friendly, he's professional, all those things. And those are the qualities he hires to. So the entire cast of characters there, the entire staff embody those qualities. Call them 317-849-2933. Become its next new patient like I did 27 years ago this week. How about that? We are at Colts camp. They're going to practice inside today because of the threat of storms. They don't want to get caught out in the middle of the field with a bunch of fans around, a bunch of media around, with potential thunderstorms in the area. So they're going to go inside. And that's one of the nice things about being at Grand Park is that they've got three full-size football fields that exist side to side under the big giant place in the middle of this complex, and so they can get all their work done on the inside and not have to worry about storms. If there's any threat of storms, they go inside. But before we get to the Colts, let's talk about basketball recruiting, because we learned something yesterday that Miles Tate from Roebuck, South Carolina, he has committed to be a Butler Bulldog, and that's a good thing. He's ranked just outside the top 100 nationally, and they are very, very fond of this kid. Laval Jordan, that's a good get for Laval Jordan. He's a Big East type player. He had an offer from Clemson, had an offer from some other schools, but Clemson, that's kind of this kid's backyard, and Brad Brownell saw him as being a potentially big-time piece for the Clemson Tigers. Butler comes in, snags the kid. And then we've got Anthony Leal, the kid from Bloomington South, who's got it down to two. He's either going to go to Indiana or Stanford. He's going to reveal where he's going to go this Friday. And what I'm hearing is that it's Indiana. I wouldn't blame him if he went to Stanford. It's a beautiful place. It's a one-of-a-kind campus. It's a unique, unique institution. But I've heard that it's going to be Indiana for Anthony Leal. And that means that Archie Miller, if that comes to pass, Archie Miller will continue to kind of keep his promise that he's going to recruit the living hell out of Indiana and win or lose with Indiana kids. I think he's going to wind up winning with Indiana kids. Anthony Leal is a kid inside the top 100, just outside the top 50. One of the kids who projects to be kind of a four-year player. He, along with Trey Galloway, would comprise at this point the 2020 recruiting class for Archie Miller. The 19 class, Trace Jackson Davis, Armon Franklin, among those who've come in. Also, Joey Brunk is a grad-eligible transfer. Indiana kid, check, 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 check. All over the place. I love Indiana kids going to Indiana. Indiana, if it's going to get back in the national conversation for championships and for deep runs in the NCAA tournament and for Big Ten championships on a consistent basis, it's going to have to recruit Indiana at an extremely high level. The Colts out here, like I said, we, let's talk to Quincy Wilson about how camp's going for him. Quincy, what's the difference this camp from other camps? It looks like you're more confident, and it looks like you're doing little things. You know what I mean? What's the difference?
The difference is I just know what to expect now. You know what I'm saying? I know what the coaches want out of me. I'm finally in shape, so I know what it takes. And, you know, after last year, what I did to get on the field is just I'm just doing the same things again. You know what I'm saying? I'm in shape. I'm running to the ball, and I'm just doing what the coach is asking me.
The in shape part, was that an injury thing, or is that just you maturing and knowing what you got to do to get here in shape?
Maturity thing, I'd say. I just know what it has to be now, pretty much. Like, I just came in shape and just ready to run all day, because you know that's what it is. We're just out here running around. And it's done me some good. I don't feel as gassed out during practices now, so I can focus on my technique and other things and not worry about being tired. You know what I'm saying?
How do you measure yourself out here? I mean, what is this, the eighth practice, whatever it is. I mean, it's a lot of practices before you go against anybody else other than your teammates. How do you measure yourself?
I just watch the film every day. And, I mean, at this point, you pretty much can coach yourselves. Like, you know what the technique's supposed to look like. You know what you're supposed to be doing. So, I mean, at this point, I just go back and watch myself. I mean, and just grade myself and watch my techniques, and I know during practice what it feels like, what it should feel like. So that's just how I come at it.
Last year we talked about Mike Mitchell and the impact he had upon you as a leader. You're in your third camp. You got to kind of be a leader now. What did he teach you about leadership?
I mean, when I first met him, the first thing he told me about was my attitude. I just got to come in every day with a good attitude, open attitude, and just not be closed-minded to things like how the coaches put me at dime, they put me at nickel. Just, you know, yes, sir, just go out there and do it, because, I mean, they got the best interest in hand, and it's been working out for me. So, you know, I just tell those rookies it's going to be a long season. You're going to keep hearing coaches' mouth. You don't want to keep hearing it. You're going to keep hearing it. So just have a good attitude, and things will work out in your favor.
Thanks, Quincy. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
That's Colts quarterback Quincy Wilson, who I think's got a hell of a chance to get some run at cornerback this year for the Indianapolis Colts and do some really good things. He is just 22 years old, even though this is his third season with the Colts. Let's also talk to the great Nick Sirianni, the offensive coordinator of the Indianapolis Colts. We first ask him about whether Reece Fountain needs to become a little bit more consistent in his play during camp.
Yeah, we want our players to be consistent and to do it over and over and over again. Those are guys we know we can count on, and that's 100%. You know, he has flashes, and our job as coaches is when a guy has, and that's why they're here. That's the scouts saw, you know, Chris Ballard and his staff do a great job, and they saw the flashes in him, and that's why he's here. And it's our job as coaches to try to get those flashes as consistent as possible. We know there's going to be ups and downs, good plays, bad plays, but we need those good plays to far outweigh the bad plays, and he's on his way there.
When you say consistency, it seems like Chester Rogers has been pretty steady for you.
Hasn't he?
10 days
ago. Yeah, he's been great. I can't say enough for him and the type of camp that he's had. He's competitive, right? And I think we all know that, you know, he sees a guy that comes in and wants his spot, and he's saying uh-uh. So he competes his butt off. He's tough. You know, he's tough. He's consistent. Love what he has done. I love what he has done. I can't say enough how good his camp's been so far. We still got some more days to go, and I just want to continue to see that from Chester, because he's built a lot of trust up in us as coaches and as teammates.
What has Howard Mudd added to this coaching staff, to the locker room, to the meeting room? Yeah,
definitely experience. You know, just he's seen everything. You know, he's seen what, hey, we've seen that look. Here's what we could do off of that look. Like, you know, all of us, I don't know if you add up all the offensive coaches' years, do we equal Howard's? You guys have to do the math on that. But he's seen everything and just, you know, seen every type of different type of player. And so his experience is awesome. And an experience means nothing if you don't have a lot of skill at what you do. And he has a ton of skill at what he does, you know. He's known as one of the best offensive line coaches ever to coach this game, which I think is flattering. And he shows that to us, and it's very helpful. So it's his experience and his skill really help us out.
Does he seem to have a solution for a problem even before you guys talk?
Yeah. His mind's constantly working. His mind's constantly working, and he works. Him and Coach Strauss work great together. Work fantastic together. They've known each other before this, so it's a great working relationship. And he's been a great asset for our coaching staff.
Nick talks about wanting a clean pocket for the quarterback. Knowing, I mean, you get the defense trying to do what they do, but in your mind, what's a clean pocket?
Clean pocket is when there is the quarterback drops back to 10, the defensive ends rush around them, 9.5 to 10. Defensive ends rush around them, we step up to it. And when we have to step up because the defensive end is coming up the field, we step up into nothing. You know, the offensive line is anchored, all right, where they are, and we can step up into our throw, right? This might be a little uncomfortable with the mic there. We want that mic. Sorry, I'm a demonstration guy. We want that mic here so we can throw and step and finish our throw. Sorry.
Knowing that you're getting pressure, but the interior pressures are pocket probably where you're more concerned with.
100%. And that also goes, and what else goes into that is just getting a hat for a hat, knowing what their pressures are. Coach Rathman and Coach Marcus Brady, they do an unreal job of breaking down the pressures of a defense. So understanding what pressures they bring out of different packages, getting us into the right call as far as the center and the quarterback, based off of what the, you know, we've told them that, hey, this is our protection call versus this, and then adjusting, because adjustments in this game are huge. I mean, they're gonna naturally bring something that you don't anticipate, right? Everyone's got something in their pocket, and they might not show it preseason one, but we know we got to be ready and play our rules and to be ready for that, and then adjust on the field as a group, as a coaching staff and as players together.
With Hale Hinges, he didn't have a lot of opportunities catching the ball at Alabama, but it seems like he's taking advantage of his reps here. What have you seen from him? And we're all looking for an undrafted guy to look for, and it seems like he's kind of shot up a little bit.
Yeah, I was joking with George Odom yesterday. I said, you guys can't cover him in one-on-ones. I think he's undefeated, and we continued that joke into when we watch one-on-ones with everybody today. He's a guy that obviously Alabama was their – you know, their number two, their guy that they put in to run block and to move people in the run game, which he can definitely do that. I've seen just consistency out of him, a lot of consistency of just, hey, I know what to expect in the run game. And then he's surprising us in the pass game, right? Because it doesn't seem like he, right? I'm not going to say anything I don't say to him. We know he's not the most athletic guy, but he just finds a way to get open. He finds a way to get open. And even when he doesn't find a way to get open, he catches the football. And, you know, that's ultimately what a receiver and a tight end, when the ball is in the air, are judged upon.
Shades of Jack Doyle, I guess, at that point.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair, yeah.
That's Nick Sirianni, Colts offensive coordinator, who's got to be pretty happy with the way his team has moved the ball against the Colts defense. Colts defense, they win some battles. Colts offense, they win some other battles. And the one yesterday that was very, very impressive, right at the end of practice, a Brissett to Fountain completion for a ton of yards. I don't know how many yards, but it was a deep ball, and Reece Fountain went up and got it. And Nick Sirianni's got to feel pretty good about the way they've been able to go get chunk yards, whether T.Y. Hilton and Andrew Luck are on the shelf or not. T.Y., not with an injury, just with some maintenance days, but Andrew Luck, as we know, is dealing with that balky calf. Let's talk about the Cubs. Cubs, last night, winners 6-5 against the Oakland Athletics in a rematch in the 1929 World Series, which did not go very well for the Chicago Cubs. They lost that series in five games, but last night, a measure of revenge, even though the Athletics have moved from Philadelphia to Kansas City and then to Oakland. It's not really, I don't think it's really relevant to the A's. I wonder how many guys on the A's actually know that that team played in Philadelphia. Into the 1950s and then the 60s before moving to Kansas City and then finally to Oakland. Steve Cishek was not good last night for the Chicago Cubs, but Javi Baez was good enough for the Cubs to score enough runs to beat the A's. Baez with two dingers last night. Castellanos with a home run. So did Ian Happ have a home run. Kyle Hendricks was terrific. We'll see if the Cubs can get it done tonight against the A's. 8:05 the starting time for the Chicago Cubs at Wrigley Field as this homestand kind of comes to a close. If the Cubs can win tonight and then tomorrow afternoon, they'd sweep the stand all six games before they go out of town. They will go to Cincinnati, Philadelphia, and then Pittsburgh for a 10-game road trip, and the Cubs have got to find a way to get better on the road. Their road record, absolutely abysmal. It says as abysmal as their home record is terrific. So they got a 2.5-game lead in the National League Central. Let's hope they can expand that and use this time to really make some hay. If they can get that done while the bullpen tries to get healthy, while Ben Zobrist is continuing to find his way back to the major leagues as a guy, he's been playing in South Bend. He's going to go to Myrtle Beach. He'll probably spend a couple of days in Iowa before finally getting back to the Chicago Cubs. And I know the Cubs are looking forward to him being back. The 38-year-old is a hell of a leader on that team. And the Cubs, you know what? It's not they'll go as far as Ben Zobrist will take him. But Ben Zobrist, an important component for the Chicago Cubs and a component that brings depth to the Chicago Cubs for this stretch run, hopefully their fifth consecutive postseason berth. This has been Sports and Other But Sports with Kent Sterling for Tuesday, August 6th, 2019. Brought to you by the great people at Today's Dentistry. Give them a call, 317-849-2933. Tomorrow morning, Breakfast with Kent, 8 o'clock on Facebook Live, and then at about 8:15 on Periscope Live. It is a show so nice that we do it twice. And of course, we'll be back here, and not back here at Colts Camp, but we'll be talking about the Colts tomorrow afternoon at 3. Sports, nothing but sports. Colts, an off day tomorrow. Game day Thursday, off day again on Friday. Can't wait to talk to you tomorrow morning. Breakfast with Kent. Join me.